Welcome everyone today to the memorial service for Doris Holcroft and welcoming the family. And thank you so much for being here with us. And then those who are joining on Zoom, we're glad that you were able to participate in this way. The family wanted me to express how appreciative they were that you would come to honor Doris in this way and to be with us. So let's begin. Dying, Christ destroyed our death. Rising, Christ restored our life. Christ will come again in glory. As in baptism, Doris Holcroft put on Christ, so in Christ may Doris be clothed with glory. Here and now, dear friends, we are children of God. What we shall be has not yet been revealed, but we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. Those who have this hope purify themselves as Christ is pure. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Jesus said, I am the Alpha and the Omega. I am the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also. And today, this is our hope that we have for us and for Doris. Friends and family, we have gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Doris. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow we may find hope, and in death we may find resurrection. We're singing today several of the hymns. One thing about Doris that she would share often is that she loved the choir here at Berkeley United Methodist Church. And so we chose some hymns that the choir has sung before. To be able to sing, lifting up praise to God as Doris loved to, with some of the songs that meant so much to her. So our first hymn that we're singing is in the hymnal on page 374. If you would like to join in and sing here, and those at home, if you would like to join in and sing with us, enjoy that as we sing. Hold on just a second.
Of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises, standing on the promises, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing on the promises, promises. I'm standing on the promises of God.
Standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God.
Of Christ the Lord, bound again eternally by a strong cord, overcoming daily with the Spirit's sword, standing on Savior as my all in all, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises, standing on the promises, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing on the promises, standing on the promises. I'm standing on the promises of God.
Please join me in prayer. Eternal God, we praise you for the great company of all those who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labor. We praise you for those dear to us whom we name in our hearts before you. Especially, we praise you today for Doris, whom you have graciously received into your presence. To all of these, grant your peace. Let your perpetual light shine upon them and help us so to believe where we have not seen, that your presence may lead us through our years and bring us at last with them into the joy of your home, not made with hands, but eternal in the heavens through Jesus Christ our Lord. God, we just pray today for your presence to just be in a very strong and perceptible way here in the sanctuary. We also pray in each home where people are gathered, have joined for the memorial service today, that your presence would be there also. We join with you in celebrating Doris's life, and we thank you for joining with us in our grief for the loss. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Scripture has a way of really kind of speaking to our heart, both expressing what's going on in our heart, and also speaking words of comfort to our heart. Psalm 30 is a psalm that really expresses the depths of the hurt and pain and the emptiness and loneliness that the psalmist was feeling, and can really get at the heart oftentimes for us when we're at a loss to express what's going on with us. Here is Psalm 131. Out of the depths I cry unto thee, O Lord. Lord, hear my cry. Let your ear be attentive to the voice of my supplication. If you, Lord, should mark my iniquities, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with thee, that thou may be feared. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in God's word do I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than those who watch in the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is great mercy, with God is plenteous redemption, and God will redeem Israel from all of their sins. And in response, there's a beautiful passage in 43, as our hearts oftentimes cry out in the pain that we're experiencing and the loss, and also crying out for in loneliness, asking for where is our help. And Saul, the prophet in Isaiah 43 shares with us some words about the assurance of who God is in the midst of our hurt and loneliness. From Isaiah 43. But now this is what the Lord says, God who created you, O Jacob, God who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. I will bring your children from the east and gather you up from the west. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not hold them back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth, everyone who is called by my name, who I created for my glory, who I formed and made. Yes, and from ancient of days, I am God. No one can deliver out of my hand. When I act, who can reverse it? I am the Lord, your Holy One, Israel's creator, your king. Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I'm doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the desert and streams in the wasteland. I, even I, am God who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more. This is what the Lord says, Israel's King and Redeemer, the Lord Almighty. I am the first and I am the last. Apart from me, there is no God. Do not tremble. Do not be afraid. Did I not proclaim this and foretell it long ago? You are my witnesses. I am God. And so there's a comfort knowing that there's something beyond ourselves, stronger than ourselves, that is both real and is both present, cares for us and is willing to work on our behalf. Next, Psalm 23, again, shares amazing words of comfort because there is a God who cares for us. Psalm 23 expresses very clearly what that can be for us in situations like this. Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want anything. God makes me to lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters. God restores my soul. God leads me in the paths of righteousness for God's own sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for God is with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. In the New Testament, Romans speaks to us again of the presence of God and the power of God, specifically for what God has done for us in Jesus Christ. From Romans 8, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set us free from the law of sin and death. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit that dwells in you. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If in fact we suffer with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to God's purpose. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? God, who did not withhold God's own Son, but gave him up for all of us, will God not also, along with him, give us everything else? Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword, as it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through Christ who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, rulers, things present, things to come, powers, no height, no depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Beautiful words of comfort. Doris's son, Dale, found Doris's favorite Bible, and she had a passage of scripture marked in that I wanted to share with us today also, that really, as I was thinking and praying about today and reflecting on Doris's life, really became the focus for me. This is in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 through 13. As you hear these words about God's love, I know that it will bring up memories and reflections on who Doris is. 1 Corinthians 13. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no records of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. Where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became older, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror, then we will see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Another favorite of Doris, another favorite hymn of Doris is Blessed Assurance. In your hymnal, this will be on page 369. Feel free to join and sing with us. And then finally, words from Jesus that offer great comfort for us. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. I have said these things to you while I'm still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, with whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I've said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." Beautiful words of comfort. So, unfortunately, I didn't have the opportunity to meet Doris. I've been here at the church for only a few months. And so, later on, Doris's sons are going to come and share about her life. And so, I'll let them have the primary bit of that. But as I was preparing for the memorial service today in prayer, I just couldn't get out of my mind this phrase that one of the sons, Mark, shared when I was visiting with them last week. He said that his mom, when he thinks about her, that she was incredibly patient. And in every way that she interacted with them and with people, that she was patient. That she was pretty quiet, soft-spoken. Over time, though, increased in her sense of humor, I understand. And that was confirmed by some of the ladies in her Bible study, talking about some of the quirks that she would point out from time to time. Her patience would seem in her artwork. Her sons described me the process by which she would make her artistic eggs, where she would poke holes in the top and bottom of the egg and then stir up the yolk in there so it'd break it up, and then have the boys literally blow in the top to blow the yolk out of the bottom. I'm saying they gained a lot of patience through that, I would guess. But in her artwork, she had this patience, very meticulous. And then I know all of you know some of her artwork. We have some of it here today, and it was beautiful. You might say to raise four boys that someone naturally either has to have patience or they will gain patience for sure. But the phrase that Mark shared with me that day, I just couldn't get him out of mind, where he said he knew that her patience came out of the love that she had in her. And that enabled her to be patient. And like I said, I just couldn't get that out of my mind. And you saw in her crafts and her artwork, this gift of love, that every piece of her artwork was a creative gift of love and patience to be a blessing to other people. And that was, from what I understand, that primary expression of that love, which is beautiful. Her sons just emphasized to me how great a mom that she was. Each of them said that to me in some way. And I was so glad that Erica was able to be here to represent her generation of the family, because they talked about how great a grandmother she was and how much she loved and cared for her grandkids. But one of the things that the brothers shared with me that was really, to me, the proof of what a loving, patient person and mom that she was how the four of them talked about how in the later years of her life, when she became more dependent on them in different ways, about how a joy and a privilege it was for them to come back and to be with her and to serve her and to give her. You know, this can be done in a dutiful way. You know, we as children, as our parents become dependent, we can see it as our duty to do what needs to happen for them, to care for them. And that's noble in a way. But when the sons talked about it, they talked about what a joy it was. Talked about going to museums together or talking or sharing, or Craig coming back many times on trips from far away to see her. And so it was just this idea of them talking about how privileged they were to give back that really is an evidence to me that they had felt so loved by her that they were willing to do that. And that was, to me, a beautiful expression of who she was and what she has done for the four of you. Doris was very committed to her faith in Christ. She got a deep sense from God, that love and that patience. And that was really the thing that, you know, coming to this passage from 1 Corinthians 13 and Mark sharing that, where this passage describes what love is in its many expressions. And he sharing that the primary expression he saw that was through the patience. And it's just, for me, that scripture was so just evident of that's the passage in her Bible that she had marked. And I can see her going back there many times, reading that description of love, trying to allow herself to be open to God so that love of God could come in her, so that she could express that love to other people. And so I got a deep sense from God that love and patience in and through Doris was really God's message to those of you who've experienced her love over the years. That love that she had was obviously a love that she gave, but it was a deep love of God for you that God was trying to express through her. That patience that you saw was a gift of God to you. 1 Corinthians 13, again, many expressions of the way love expressed, all these different words, kindness, faithfulness, patience, perseverance. I sense the message that God was wanting to speak specifically to the family and those who know and love Doris, that this God of love that you experienced through your mom and your grandmother, your friend, was God's word that God has created you. God has sent Christ on your behalf to show you God's love. And God goes and prepares a place for you, even as he prepared a place for Doris. And God's desire is that through her life and through really this very specific scripture describing God's love, that God would want to open up to you more expressions of God's deep love for you. Something very personal about this passage of scripture for me, and so I was so moved when Dell shared with me that this was so meaningful to Doris, is there was a point when I was a teenager when I had really just hadn't been paying attention to God. I'd really kind of gone my own way. And it was through reading this passage of scripture that I really sensed God speak to my heart for the first time. And this is the message that I felt God gave to me through this passage of scripture, that this description of love was the love that God had for me. And his desire was that the rest of my life, I would be open to be able to understand and experience that more deeply as life went on. And ultimately that this description of love was the way that God desired for me to love other people. And so it was a very transforming moment in my life to experience God's love at a deep level for the first time, and to have a desire to love in that way. And so again, when I heard from Dell that was her favorite scripture, it really spoke to me. So here today, that God's deep love for Doris is that Christ has gone to prepare a place for her, and we can have that hope for her. And here today, that remembering back on the love and kindness and many gifts that Doris has given you, that is a message of God's love for you. There's a passage of scripture in James that's always been very significant for me. It simply says that every good and perfect gift comes from the Father of lights. And to those that James was writing this, he was trying to say for them to recognize that if something good was in their life, that that was a gift of God to them. And he was writing that to encourage them as a result of recognizing that, to turn and give thanks to God. And so it's been a really habit of mine to reflect on my life and to think about things that are good in my life, either something I've been given or something that I've just been blessed in some way, or even if I've done anything good in my life, and turning and recognizing that God has given me that and giving God thanks and praise for that. And I love doing that for other people also. When I see good things in other people or other people are blessed, I'll turn to God and give God thanks for the good things in their life. And so in particular, when I'm reflecting on someone who's died, and as I said, I didn't meet Doris, but as I've heard from the brothers and from folks at Berkeley about who Doris was and the blessing she was, it's just caused me to turn and give thanks and praise to God. I celebrate today with you who Doris was and give praise to God for that. It's beautiful. Alongside of that, we grieve. We're fortunate that, although Doris had some difficult times health-wise at the end, that it was a peaceful way for her to die, and that's a blessing. And she lived a good full life, and that's exciting. But still, that it still hurts. And we're, as Dale said, you know it's coming, but then it's still a shocker, and it's difficult. And so what I want to share with you words of comfort today is that I believe that God grieves along with us for Doris's death. My understanding from the creation story, as it describes that God created humans in God's own image, and part of God's image that I believe God created us in is that he created us to live forever, and that sin was, death was only introduced when the fall of the sin came. And so when Adam and Eve, the first humans to die, when they died, it broke God's heart, because God's plan was for them physically to live forever. And so I believe that every time one of God's creations that God created in God's image in a special way, when we die, God grieves for that. And that wasn't God's plan for us initially. And so there is this beautiful picture of God being with us in our sadness also. A beautiful word that Jesus spoke to his disciples. He said, "Blessed are you who mourn, for you will be comforted." And I believe the reason we can be comforted in our mourning is because God is here with us, mourning alongside of us. Christ is present with us to mourn with us and to receive our mourning into God's self. As we think about those places of hurt, talked about with the brothers, that sometimes there's regrets or unsettled things that can be difficult also. My invitation for people with whatever emotions they're going through in the grief process to open those up and to express those, to share those with someone. I had such an amazing time with the four sons last week, and they shared the joys and remembrances of their mom, but also the grief and hurt that they were feeling. And I was very touched by that and honored that they would share that with me. And being able to share that with someone else to get that out is very helpful. And in particular, I invite people, in whatever connection you have with God, to invite people to open up and share with God the pain, the hurt, the grief, the loneliness, the loss. And I have found to be God a very present listener and healer and giver of comfort. And so I invite you into that. And so we get to these times and we say, well, what is the meaning of it all? Scripture says that people are like grass in the fields or flowers that wither and fall away. We know that each of us are going to come to a place of death. And it causes these questions and uncertainties and what's the purpose of it all come to our mind. And this is the encouragement that I believe in my heart and receive from Scripture, is that we are precious in God's sight. And God cares for each one of us. And God's invitation was that as we are baptized into Christ and have connection with Christ through faith, that as Christ died a human life or human death, as Christ was raised from the dead, that if we are in Christ, that we are raised with Christ also. And as these words of comfort that we read today from Jesus, that Christ has given us new eternal life. Christ has gone to prepare a place for us. One of the fascinating things that I heard from Doris's sons when we were talking is that each home that Doris had was very important and special to her. And her things were very important and special to her. Regardless of where she went, it was a meaningful place for her. And I like to say that our homes, it's not necessarily about the building that we have, but it's having a place is so significant. And they express that significance to me for her. And I believe that God puts this desire for a place to feel at home and feel welcome in our hearts. And ultimately that in Christ, he invites us to know that eternally that Christ has prepared a place for us. And so our hope for Doris is that as she had faith in Christ, that she is with Christ, and that the resurrection is what brings the resolve for her. And my invitation for you to consider today is that same resurrection power of the love of the love of God raising Christ from the dead is the resolve for us also. In the hurt and pain and loneliness and difficulty that we have in that, in the loss, Christ invites us to share that with him. And Christ takes that pain upon himself on the cross, and they die with him. And then the power of the resurrection can come and restore and heal and give comfort and love in the place that we feel lost. And I pray for that for you as Doris's family, and for those of you who mourn for Doris, I pray for that comfort of the presence of Christ through the resurrection. Let's pray. God, we do give you thanks for Doris, who she was and the blessings she was for us. We celebrate her life and give you thanks for it. And God, we trust that she is in your hands and that you have a place for her. And I pray especially for her four sons. I pray for her grandchildren, all the rest of her family. I pray that they would know the comfort of your love and patience, and that they would sense in their heart the expressions of love that God has for them in Christ. And I pray for everyone who's grieving in this, that you would be very present for them in the grief. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. I'm inviting one of Doris's sons, Dale, to come and share with us the naming or the obituary for Doris. Come on up now.
On Monday, January 11th this year, Doris Virginia Weissman Holdcroft, artist and loving mother of four sons, passed away at the age of 94 here in Austin. Doris was born on June 5th, 1926 in Farmdale, Ohio, a rural community north of Youngstown. Her parents, Harry White and Ethel White, lived their entire lives in Trumbull County, Ohio, where they raised five daughters, Corrine, Eileen, Carol, Doris, and Marilyn. Doris graduated from Gustavus High School, worked in a factory to support our nation's World War II effort, and attended Ohio State University in Columbus, where she met Ralph Edward Weissman, her first husband and our father. Doris and Ralph, a U.S. Air Force pilot, wed on September 6, 1947. Doris created her wedding dress from one of Ralph's silk parachutes. Doris and Ralph lived in Ohio until 1955, when they moved with their three sons, Daryl, Mark, and Dale, to Europe, where Ralph was stationed at Air Force bases in Germany and France. Doris and Ralph traveled throughout Western Europe while stationed overseas and returned to the United States in 1960. They moved to Lubbock, Texas, where the fourth son, Craig, was born and where Ralph served as an aircraft maintenance officer and pilot at Reese Air Force Base. After Ralph retired from the Air Force as a lieutenant colonel in 1967, the Wiseman family moved to a country home near Edinburgh, Texas, in the lower Rio Grande Valley. Ralph passed away on November 20th, 1977, at the age of 55. Doris later moved to McAllen, Texas, and in 1986, married Fred G. Holdcroft, who died in a McAllen hospital in 1999. Doris then moved to Austin, Texas in 2003 to live near her three Austin-based sons and granddaughter. Doris was a voracious, lifelong reader who as a child read up to 14 books a week. While living in Lubbock, she cultivated a passion for arts and crafts and perfected the art form of elaborately decorated Fabergé-style eggs. She won numerous awards in major Texas art shows in the mid-1970s. She also mastered the ancient Japanese folk art of embroidered tamari, or handballs, and also handcrafted thousands of artfully designed greeting cards. Over the decades, she frequently donated her artwork and handicrafts for charitable fundraising events. Doris loved all creatures great and small, especially colorful hummingbirds and butterflies, which adorn many of her artistic creations. She navigated life with love, generosity, optimism, and a gentle spirit and a wry sense of humor.
Thank you, Dale. And now Doris's four sons are going to come and share their thoughts and remembrances of Doris.
Hello, I'm Daryl. I'm the oldest son, and I'm here to witness for my mother, Doris Virginia Holdcroft, who I have known for 70 years and probably longer than anybody else. And the highlights of her life have already been pretty much covered in Dale's excellent obituary. But I want to talk about when she moved to Austin after living in McAllen, South Texas for 35 years. This was at the age of 77, and she had, you know, to me, it was a really brave thing to do. She could have stayed down there. She had her church. She had her charitable work. She had her arts and crafts, but she felt the need to move up here, and we agonized about it. It was a brutal move, brutal, but we got it done, and after, you know, she spent a year and a half, 2 years kind of living in a rental unit, and we finally found a little South Austin bungalow for her, shoehorned all her possessions in there, all her artwork, and we went from there. But anyway, the thing about the last 17 years is that this is the time she became more than a mother, if that's appropriate to say. She became a confidant and a friend to me. I mean, you know, kids and parents, there's all kinds of stuff that goes on. But I became really close to my mother in these later years. And I just remember there's so many funny stories, I can't even get my head around it. And, but the thing about her car, she had this 2003 Toyota Corolla that was in mint condition that she had bought in McAllen, and we drove it up here from the valley, almost killed my knees because it was so tiny. But she just loved that car. She, a woman who was afraid basically to drive when we were kids, who would only make right-hand turns driving around Lubbock, Texas, was motoring around Austin, you know, the metropolis, which was kind of crazy. But she'd find her little back ways to get everywhere. And and she did great. And that car, we finally, when she was 93, she had this confession to make, where she said, "You know what? I sometimes don't remember where I'm going in the car, but the car remembers." And that is so clever, because it shows you that it, in a certain way, she's being funny. She was hilarious. She was absolutely hilarious. And, but in a certain way, she was saying, you know, maybe I'm done. Maybe I'm done driving. That was a really rough transition getting her off that car, because she turned over the keys, and then we would find the car. Well, it took her, yes, we'd find the car warm in the garage, or one time a brother found her out sitting in the driveway in the car. And so she was sneaking around. So anyway, we finally had to sell the car, because it was really bothering her to look at it every day at the house. So there's some sort of weird metaphor here about her life in this car, an old car in mint condition with only 27,000 miles on it, you know, a 2003 Toyota. So I hope I'm not making too big a deal out of it, but to me, this is symbolic of her life and the way she lived her life. And she was very kind to people, and very accepting. And anyway, I've got, that's just one of many stories. I've got people, just a few people to thank. And to me, this, when you talk about how people kind of reacted to her and gave back to her, it was because she was so open to people. She, you know, there would be folks from the church that would come by the house and visit as she got older and less able to attend, things like that. And anyway, let me just kind of read a few of these. We want to thank, of course, Berkeley United, her church family. When she first came to Austin, she went to several different churches, you know, a time or two, and no, it wasn't quite right. She finally found Berkeley, and it was a perfect fit. She was so happy to be a member here and had so many friends. Want to thank Ann and Mary Basio, who were carers that that helped her in the house. We were determined for the longest time to keep her at home. That was her wishes. But she ended up going to Elmcroft Assisted Living. And I thought, oh boy, it was really upsetting. She isn't going to be able to handle this, because she's a people person, but she did like her solitude and was fine with that. But she actually became friends with a lot of people there. And in the last month of her life, she told me that she felt peaceful, at peace, and she felt safe there. So I'd second guessed our choices about that sort of thing, but it seems to have been what she needed. She needed that extra contact with people. So thanks to the Elmcroft frontline staff, sweet people. They'd call her Miss Doris. It was lovely. Adult Care of Austin, her family doctor, Seton South Austin Medical, Encompass Rehab, Baldwin's Hair Salon. Mom, you can tip them more than $5, you know. You know, it is the 2000s now, or 2100s, whatever. So also one of her physicians, physician assistant by the name of Michael, I'm paraphrasing, but he would actually make house calls, so to speak, by walking from his office over to Elmcroft and, you know, treating her for medical issues. Now, what doctor does that? And upon her death, I'm paraphrasing, but he said that he was devastated by the loss of our mother, that she was his favorite patient, and he loved seeing her. And, you know, it was perfectly great for him to swing by there and just walk in and treat her. So that was a great thing. There were other people there. We finally got to go in the assisted living. The COVID, as you all know, has messed everything up. But we got to go in, and one day there was a physical therapist in her room, and he's saying, well, come on, let's do your physical therapy. And she looked at him and raised her hand and started going like that. So that's that was, I can't even tell you how funny she was. Anyway, at the very end, it was like things just sort of fell away. Before, she would always, in her quest for, you know, wondering what was going on, would ask, how are things? What's going on, you know, when we would see her. But toward the end, she stopped doing that, and things fell away. And she basically spent a lot of time in her room there watching the leaves fall and watching the birds in the trees. And that gave her a lot of joy. That was a, nature was a really big deal to her. And I don't know, kind of gets to me actually, thinking about it. But anyway, things kind of fell away, and you could feel this sense of spirituality coming over her. And I feel really blessed that she did tell me about how that she felt good being at Elmcroft. And, you know, she was the one saying, I may never go back to the house, but we were holding out hope. It just wasn't meant to be. But anyway, she was a wonderful, wonderful person. And the 17 years when we got so close, I wouldn't trade for them for anything. And I'm going to turn it over to another brother. I've got two pages of scribbles here. I could go on and on, but I'll pass the buck. Thank you all for honoring our mother.
I'm grateful for this opportunity to share some of the recollections of my mother. And I'm also thankful for the pastor for including in large part some of my observations about her that I found to be very meaningful. And as was mentioned, there's a very close association between patience and love, and also patience and caring. And as Daryl mentioned, living in the little house located very close to the Greenbelt, she befriended every critter possible. She visited and she fed them. And of course, no animal in the right mind would give up a free meal. And she was visited by possums. And she, of course, had bird feeders and was visited by hummingbirds in the summer. And she took a great deal of joy about those animals. And that was just part of her caring, which is also related, I believe, to patience. And some might look at her life and kind of look askance and maybe say that it was an unfulfilled life. But I don't think that that was the case. A lot of people evaluate the quality of a person's life by how extravagant they might have lived. If they jet-setted around the world and went to Monte Carlo on a yacht. And we think of that as living large. But my mom, Doris, she lived small. And she was better for that, I think. She noticed the little things in life that were very, very meaningful to her. And she relished in reading, as Dale mentioned in the obituary. And it just never amazed me how many books that she could devour. And in fact, that was her travel throughout the world. She experienced life in the written word, in books, And that was both traveling around the world, but also traveling in time, because she really liked the Victorian age. She read books about life on the Great Plains in the early years of this country. And so that was her way of living to the fullest extent possible. And I'll always remember her as a very, very caring person and who experienced life in her own backyard and also through books. Thank you for your time.
I'm Dale. I can't do such a great job of extemporaneous speaking like my brother, so I have to use a script to get through this. And I'm going to echo some themes that they brought up as well as were in the obituary. But first, before I get started, you know, Rusty, I really want to thank you for hosting this memorial service for our mom and supporting the Wiseman family as we work through our grief and loss. And I'd like to thank the Berkeley Ministry Congregation Choir and staff for providing such a loving community for Doris all these many years. You know, Berkeley really meant a lot to her, and it was a solid foundation that she could always rely on. Mom loved family and social gatherings, you know, and she would have loved being here with us at this moment. And perhaps she is in ways that we really can't know. Doris was a loving mom, and she shared her love in many unspoken ways and through her lifelong support and generous spirit. She loved many things in life: her husbands, her four boys, her grandchildren, extended family, church friends, birds and butterflies, and last but not least, books and art. And I want to talk about these. As we have noted, Doris really loved reading from an early age. You know, mysteries, thrillers, romance, historical novels provided a form of escape from her armchair. Later in life, she kept a notebook, and here it is, that was a list of all the books she read, and hundreds of titles. It's more than I've read. Her love of literature had a profound influence on me since childhood and throughout my life. And I'm grateful for that gift. Doris loved creating and collecting arts and crafts most of all. She had a habit of jotting down favorite quips and quotes on slips of paper, including this gem that I found from Pablo Picasso: "Art washes from the soul the dust of everyday life." So as a talented artist, Doris really didn't have much dust on her soul. The diversity of her arts and crafts, which you can see on this table display, is amazing. The ornately decorated eggs, the Japanese tamari, the handcrafted greeting cards, beaded necklaces, Christmas tree ornaments, the Texas mosquito, which is very unique, landscape paintings, to name a few. She was an expert in needlecraft, paper quilling, and decoupage. She avidly collected arts and crafts also at flea markets and art festivals and from eBay. I mean, she had her own computer and she bought stuff on eBay, you know, well into her 80s and early 90s, which is pretty amazing. And she surrounded herself with beautiful things that brought joy and comfort to her life. She was very generous too with her artistic creations and donating them for fundraising events here at Berkeley and other churches and schools. Finally, our mom loved to worry. And I got that from her big time. I mean, I'm a classic worrier. But I think she worried in a good way. She worried about bad weather, bad traffic, household dangers, automotive hazards, my motorcycling. She worried enough for the whole family and kept us well advised. So when a thunderstorm was brewing or a deep freeze was imminent, she would call or email to be sure we were prepared and safe. I learned from her to keep my toaster and coffee pot unplugged, you know, because you don't want to have a house fire. I used to roll my eyes at her emails and calls about the weather or any number of threats. But I understand now, and I appreciate that she worried for all of us out of love. She wanted to keep us safe, healthy, and happy. And that's the greatest mother's gift of all. Doris leaves behind a deep legacy of love that I hope will span a generation to come and beyond. I want to end. I found this quote on my own, but I think it's a really wonderful quote that captures how we all feel about our mom. It's from Rumi, a 13th century Persian poet. "We are born of love. Love is our mother."
I'm Craig, and I want to thank you for joining us today. A few days ago, we had a conference call with Rusty, and we were all talking, and he was getting a feel, you know, about mom's life since he didn't get a chance to actually know her. And he asked, "Well, how are you feeling?" And, you know, when something like this happens, it takes a long while to kind of wrap your head around your feelings. And you have to really kind of search deep down and kind of think about and reflect. And I kind of came up with some feelings that have kind of come up in me and you've probably experienced too. Of course, the most obvious thing is sadness and sorrow, because, you know, Doris is going to be greatly missed. It's kind of calming because I know she's in a good place because of her faith. But again, it's sad because we'll never see her here. But I kind of was thinking, well, she actually is here. She's living on through us. She, physically, she's living through myself, my brothers, and grandchildren, and then also lives on through the people who know her, wives and congregation, family, everybody that contacted her are going to have memories. And she's going to continue to live on this earth in that way. So that's kind of reassuring, kind of to kind of keep the sadness and sorrow kind of to a minimum. But another one is kind of fear. When something like this happens, you start thinking about your own mortality. Like, how long am I going to live? Am I going to pass away in pain? Or is it going to be an easy death, things like that. So fear comes up. But today's message that Rusty had is very calming, to know that we're going to have everlasting life and we shouldn't fear death. And as my brother mentioned, she was a warrior. You know, she kind of was afraid of everything growing up, and she had enough fear for all of us. And when I started my flying career at UPS, I'd talk to her on the road. I'd give her a call from China, and she, that's cool that you're in China. I'd tell her what I'm doing. Or first time I was in Japan, I said, this is cool. I'm in a hotel on the 30th floor, and I got the greatest view. And the only thing she could think was, what are you going to do if there's an earthquake? Or, well, if there's a fire, how are you going to get, you need to be on the second floor. And I said, don't worry, Mom, it's really cool. There's a kickout plate on the window, and you can actually, you crawl on the outside of the building down these stairs. And that made her even more worried. I would say, well, this is really cool. I got to skirt a typhoon today. You know, I've never done anything like that. And that worried her, of course. And so I kind of learned, maybe I shouldn't be talking about too much of these things. But you know, like Dale said, she worried out of love for us. And that was great. But, you know, I can imagine if coming to the end of my life, how much fear and worry I would have. But it was amazing that Doris didn't show any of that. She was so at peace. And I think she was the bravest woman that I've ever known, just how she handled that. Yeah. Another thing that comes up is guilt. didn't spend enough time with her? Did we keep her, you know, well cared for towards the end of her life? And, you know, things like that, the guilt like that kind of crops up. But I think in the end, she would just say, just let it go. Don't worry about that. And then kind of a strangest emotion that you might deal with is happiness. It kind of sounds weird, kind of a weird emotion to have at a funeral. But I'm just so happy that she's in a good place. And I know I'll see her again soon. I'm happy about her life. You know, it was like my brother said, it was a subdued life, but she had a great life, long life. And I'm so happy for that. She started out in the Depression. She had, you know, hard times, good times, but it was a great life. And I'm happy for her in that respect. And I'm happy she's my mom. She gave me life. She gave my other brother's life. And I'm happy that I'm here. I'm forever grateful for that. And I owe her the big thanks for being my mom. And some to take away, again, it's been alluded to that she loved even the smallest things, hummingbirds and flowers and other little animals. And towards the end of her life, she, you know, had to go into assisted living and rehab and back in assisted living. And she put up with a lot. But she said, I think one of the last rooms she wanted, she says, I want a window so I can just look at the trees and see the leaves fall. So that's just very moving to me. And just, I think I'm going to take that with me for the rest of my life. Just make sure I notice the smallest things in life and not overlook just the littlest things. And sometimes we just kind of have to slow it down and enjoy little things that bring us happiness. Again, I thank you for joining us, and I just want to say I love you, Mom.
Thank you for sharing. Any of the other family that's here want to share any words? And so we'll also just invite anyone that's on the Zoom that would like to share some words about Doris to feel free just to unmute and share.
Can I say something? Rusty, is it okay to talk? I'm unmuted, but I don't know if it's coming through.
Yes, we can hear you, Rachel.
Okay, sorry. I just wanted her sons to know that I got to know Doris because of the chair she would sit in at Berkeley, and she was always there. And I started passing by her because her beautiful blue sort of silky suit she would always wear just matched her eyes so well. And I would just say she twinkled, that she had the most twinkling eyes. And I just loved that. And from that, we came to be friends more so, and enjoyed visiting her in her home. And we really would find we liked the same things, looking at the trees and the birds, and would just sit there. But she introduced me to her book Bible, as she called it, because I would bring her books I was reading. We liked the same books, Victorian novels and the Great Plains and historical novels. And I'd bring her some, and she was always very careful to mark if they were to be given away to the library or to be returned. But she showed me her book Bible, which you had there, where she had meticulously listed every book she had read by author. So if I brought one, she could look it up to see if she had already read it or not. That was so inspiring to me that I went home and made my own book Bible, which I still use. And it's is dedicated to Doris for giving me that wonderful idea. She was the most probably delightful. The words that come to mind is just delightful and perky and just like a little fairy light in my life. Visiting her just brought such delight, and I'm going to miss her terribly. And I'm so happy to get to hear all of her sons speak about her and her life. It's so meaningful to me. So I'm glad we could have this Zoom, and she will be greatly missed. But like you said there at the end, I think that was Craig, just so happy to have known her for the years that I got to know her. That's all. God bless you.
Thanks for sharing, Rachel. Is there anybody else that would like to share?
Hello, I hope you can all hear me.
Here, go ahead.
Okay, my name is Cindy Dudley. I am Doris's niece. My mom is the last remaining sister of the five sisters. My favorite story about Aunt Doris was when she and Fred came home for my grandmother's funeral. And the day after the funeral, there was a raging blizzard. We had all gathered at my Aunt Carol, another sister, at her house, and we're watching so closely the snow, wondering how long we can safely stay there. Every so often, well, Fred liked watching the cardinals out in the snow. And every so often, she'd get up, walk over to the window with that raging snow and say, "My, it just looks like a fairyland out there." And finally, I said, "Somebody get her a shovel, a pair of boots, and 10 minutes, and we'll cure that attitude." But that was my favorite story.
We would like to share Gary, her nephew.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yes, Doris was my aunt by marriage. Ralph Wiseman was my blood uncle, my mother's brother. And I just like to say that Doris was a great lady. And I really enjoyed talking with Dale quite a bit in the last couple of months toward the end of his mother's life. And we've shared several things, and I just want to mention that I've very much enjoyed talking with him. Looking forward to talking to all the brothers in the future sometime. So that's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else like to share?
Hi, this is Ted. Can you hear me?
Go ahead.
I'm an old friend of Dale's. And know Daryl. And this is my wife, Carrie. And I've only met Doris a couple of times, but once was in the late 70s, and once was just a few years ago. And it just made a real impact. She was very kind. And it's just nice to have that connection and to see the family come together. One thing that we have, that we have two grown daughters and they know of this, and is we have one of the cards, and Dale sent it to us a few years ago, and it was sewn together. And it's just something that we cherish. And,
fascinating.
Yeah, it was very fascinating, and I loved that she was an artist and enjoyed the moments so much. And it's also quite impressive, the four boys.
Yeah, the family.
Yeah, that's
nice family.
Not an easy thing.
She was a lucky lady.
Yeah. very, very wealthy in that regard. So we just thought we'd share that. And she seemed like she was just a lovely person. And we wish you all the best.
To share?
I have a story, if there's time. I hadn't gotten to share this story yet with Dale, but I'm sure he'll remember this. It was a very long time ago, probably one of the first times that I had met Doris. And Dale had a dog named Gracie at that point, a little black Cocker Spaniel, who dug underneath the deck in Dale's backyard, and she scraped the black pigment off of her nose. And we were all sort of laughing about this and speculating, like, how long is it going to take? Because her nose was pink for the longest time. And I will never forget that Christmas that Doris combined her love of animals with her love of crafts. And she made a little nose mask for Gracie out of some black construction paper with a little elastic band. And it was so funny. That sense of humor of hers, I just think that was such a clever thing that she did. And I have to say that it was such a pleasure to listen to all the reminiscences that everyone shared. The humor, the sense of humor and joy, and I think Rachel used the word delight that she brought to life, was such a special gift that she had. And I really wanted to share that story and remind Dale of when that happened. That was fabulous. Your mom was fabulous. So thanks.
Thank you.
Let's see. Anybody I'm not like sure if I'm here or not. Let's see. How do I do this?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. I'm Betsy, and my parents lived across the street from Dale and Erica and Mary. And Erica, I want to say this directly to you, how much you meant to my parents, especially my father, who had two grandsons in California. But I've known you, of course, through my dad and your dad. And I think the relationship that one has with one's grandparents, especially for you with your grandmother, is one of the most important that you'll ever have. And it's absolutely true what Craig said about when these people are in your, have been in your live life and they're gone, but they still, they come so regularly to your thoughts. And there's a photograph, Mary, you probably remember this, but a photograph of, my father and Erica when Erica's what, 5 or 6. And so I hold her in my mind. Now I haven't seen her, well, I've seen her off and on over the years, maybe in the last couple of years, but I think to have had a grandmother, a talented grandmother, and seeing how it's come out in Dale and Dale and your brothers as well, I just feel so grateful to have been connected to the family very directly through Dale. But also today, seeing the other brothers and seeing your mother coming through in each of you in different ways. So I just wanted to give you all my love and thank you so much for letting us participate today. See you all later, okay?
Thanks so much. Anybody else have some words they would like to share? For the four sons and for the others who shared, what a blessing. And to me, it's just part of what I talked about earlier, all those things that we hear and receive together, what a gift from God all these things were, and we give thanks for those. one of the things that Del shared with me is that they wanted a hymn sung, Amazing Grace, from Susan Boyle. And so we're going to share a song with some more photos of Doris. Join me in prayer. God of us all, your love never ends. When all else fails, you still are God. We pray to you for one another in our need and for all anywhere who mourn with us this day. To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, give strength. To those who have sinned, pray for mercy and grace, forgiveness. To all who have sorrow, we pray for your peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another, In all of our ways, we trust you, and to you, with your church on earth and in heaven, we offer honor and glory now and forever. Amen. Oh God, all that you have given us is yours. As first you gave us Doris, now we give Doris back to you. The brothers brought the urn that holds the ashes of Doris. God, we pray that you would receive Doris into your arms of mercy. Raise Doris up with all your people. Receive us also and raise us into a new life. Help us to so love and serve you in the world that we may enter into your joy in the world to come. Amen. Amen. God of love, we thank you for all with which you have blessed us, even to this day, for the gift of joy in the days of health and strength, and for the gifts of your abiding presence and promise in days of pain and grief. We praise you for home and friends, and for our baptism and our place in your church, with all who have faithfully lived and died. Above all else, we thank you for Jesus, who knew our griefs, who died our death, and rose for our sake, and whose lives and prays for us. And as he taught us, now we pray. Join me in the Lord's Prayer, if you will. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And finally, Erica, Doris's granddaughter, and some of her friends put together a piece that they sang that they wanted to share today. So if you can turn that back on for me, Dale.
Hello, I've gathered two of my close friends to perform a vocal offering for my grandma's service, Grandma Doris. This piece is called Lux Eterna by Sarah Quartrell. And yeah, enjoy the music.
Lux et terna.
Thank you for that offering, that gift, Erica, and your friends. It's beautiful. And now, hear this blessing as we finish today. Now may the God of peace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good, so that you may do his will, working among us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now may the Father, from whom every family on earth and on earth is named, according to the riches of God's glory, grant you to be strengthened with might through God's Spirit in your inner being, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ, which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with the fullness of God. Amen. Bless you. Thanks for coming. Again, thank you for those who joined us on Zoom, and family, thanks for being here today.